So I went back to regularly just playing the game, not hacking it with the turtle tipping or whatever, or cheating, you know, but to just go back to gameplay. And I knew I was going to beat third place, and I was definitely going to get the second place prize, which is what I wanted. And then at the end, they switched to prizes because they knew that the value was in the rentals, not in that handheld piece of crap. So I got what I thought was going to be the first place prize, and that was that little Rambo handheld thing. But in most of my existence, I would refuse to cheat, you know, just because it made the game boring and, you know, spoiled the fun and, you know, whatever. And it was an honor thing about it, you know, like, you don't cheat. And can cheat, you can try cheating, whatever, but does that really make the game better? Not really. Unless you just want to experience the end and you just want to, like, quit the game, but you don't want to quit the game without getting to the end of the game. So I would cheat in some cases just so I could see the ending of this game and not just be stuck there for another 2 weeks playing it or whatever, you know? So I think that also trained me kind of not only just as a skill but kind of as a moral value, you know, this honor code that us gamers would have, you know, to not cheat, you know, to play the game fairly and to always be in competition, not with other people necessarily, but with yourself. And it always worked for me. It always helped me have that drive to improve myself. So I've carried that to my adult life, and it's worked for me. I think that I got a lot of that from gaming. It might have been, you know, innate, whatever, born into me, but it was also something that I trained for, to not cheat and to not, you know, and also to not lie. This is something that I'm also very interested in, is lie detection software, because I don't know, I as I've gone into my adulthood and Christianity and faith and tradition, you know, I've learned a lot of things, like mostly about the Gnostics, and lately, not mostly about the Gnostics in my life, but lately I've studied mostly about the Gnostics, Coptic church in Jesus' time that followed Christ. They were Hebrews. And anyway, I've learned a lot about them, and I've learned a lot about their view of God.
Gnosticism emerged as a mixture of Platonic thought with Greek, Egyptian, and Mesopotamian mythology, along with the Christian doctrine. They believed in a good God and in an evil God, the latter of whom created the material world. In order to be saved, you had to have the special knowledge, the gnosis, that is free from all that is material. Christ was sent as the Logos of the good God to free us from the material world created by the evil God, who was often associated with the God of the Old Testament. Among the prominent figures of Gnosticism was a man named Marcion. Marcion created an edited version of the Gospel of Luke and the Epistles of Paul, where nothing about the material world appears. Marcion, together with other figures before him, such as Valentinus, were vehemently opposed by the church through figures like Ignatius of Antioch and Irenaeus of Lyon. In Irenaeus of Lyon's opposition to Marcion, the former realized the necessity of forming a list of the books the church considers as canonical scriptures.
Demiurge, as they would call the physical god of creation, the Demiurge, who is a sort of a Jekyll and Hyde kind, like a very selfish god. You hear that in the Old Testament. I am a selfish god, blah, blah, blah. And, you know, this type of contrast between the Old Testament and the New Testament god is explained in this Demiurge theory, because that's not the only god. You know, in the Old Testament we hear about Elohim, you know, that means multiple gods, you know, amongst the gods, of gods, you know, not just one god. So that is also contradicted in Isaiah, but that there is only one God. But I think that the bipolar personality of God, or what we're seeing in the Old and the New Testament, is very clearly explained in Gnosticism. So in my life now, I don't look for good and evil or righteous and unrighteous anymore. Not so much. More for me, it's about truth versus fiction. lies versus truth. I insist on truth, and so as a challenge in my life, not only just so life isn't boring and easy, or whatever, lying to get your way or whatever, but in a lot of people's lives, it makes it really easy, especially if they're incognito, if not a lot of people know about them, if they're not very obvious in the world, if they're just, in the shadows, they can manipulate their life with lies and make their life very easy, whether it be welfare, social welfare, the dole, whatever, or whether it be with people or friends or family. Liars, if they're, subversive enough and not out in the open enough, they can get away with a lot and make their life very easy. I don't like my life to be very easy. That's why I'm very accountable on social media. I've always said my piece on here for all the way back to 2000 and, whenever YouTube started, and before that even with MySpace. I've always been very direct and owning my opinions with my own face, not hiding, behind a facade or a mask, but like using my own reality and my own person, not just a personality that I've created, but me as a person. I've used myself and made myself accountable by saying what I want to say, saying my piece to everybody, and letting it be judged by the masses, if that is how it needs to be, if there needs to be judgment on my decisions or personality or person as a content maker, I'm happy to expose myself. It doesn't always work out to my benefit, or at least it doesn't always make life easy for me. But it does work out to my benefit because it does make me accountable. I made a video about how my exes are using parental alienation against me. The definition of parental alienation is they turn the children against the other parent. They intentionally use words or manipulation of some sort to turn the kids against the other parent. And so in that, I've gone through that now this year, and the first time really ever, I've had my exes threaten it, if you don't do this, then I'm going to take your kids from you, or if you don't do that, I'm going to take your kids from you. I had that for, the last 9 years, but I've never had a custody battle until this year. So I made a video about it. And my son is writing on there. I don't know if he knows that I know his name on YouTube, but I know it. I know it's him. And, a couple of other people have given me criticism about it and given me a perspective about it that I'm able to think about. But that's the best thing about being accountable and not subversively, using gossip or innuendo or, darkness to conceal your thoughts. Being out in the open, what do they say? Sunshine is the best sanitizer. Helps me clean up my act anyway. So I'm not always right, and I'm not always the most righteous, and I'm not always good, but I'm honest. And someday lie detection software and technology and algorithms, are going to be effective enough that they can use them on these videos, on anybody's video, or on live speeches, or on the phone, or in person, to analyze sincerity and truth and all that. That will happen very soon. And AI will make it very, very effective, almost 100% accurate. And, the way the cost of technology and the rate of improvement makes the price go down, it's going to be affordable for everybody to have, and lies are going to go away. And I'm happy about that in some ways, but also being honest is what sets some people apart. Because people that lie can get away with lying right now. In the future, they're not going to be able to get away with it. It's not going to be allowed. Technology won't allow people to lie. There might be technology to subvert the technology that detects lies or sincerity. But for the most part, I think sincerity and truth will be required in society. There will be no other option, because there will be no incentive to lie. If people lie in the future, when this technology exists, 100%, close enough to 100% accurate, using many different algorithms and assessments and, all that, but there will be no incentive to lie, because people will be exposed immediately. It won't take 2 weeks or 2 years for people to be exposed. People will be exposed immediately, so there will be no incentive to lie. Currently, even if people get caught, people can lie, get what they want, and, the consequences may not fall upon them for 2 years or 10 years, but they can lie and get away with it for long enough, until the truth catches up with them, and then they might suffer a few consequences, but the lie has gone on for so long and the issue has been settled for so long that the consequences are less in 10 years than they would be immediately. You know what I mean? So people still are incentivized to lie. It works for some people. In the future...
You know, Sicilians are great liars. Best in the world. I'm Sicilian. My father was the world heavyweight champion of Sicilian liars. From growing up with him, I learned the pantomime. There are 17 different things a guy can do when he lies to give himself away. Guy's got 17 pantomimes. Woman's got 20, guy's got 17. But if you know them, like you know your own face, they beat lie detectors all to hell.